Well, welcome everybody to the Sustainable Forum. Thank you very much for investing some time. We have some great speakers. When we met last year in Barcelona, World Sailing launched its sustainable strategy, which has received an incredible amount of support all around the world. Putting that strategy into practice has meant taking stock of all the opportunities across the sport. And I think you might agree with me, there's been a tremendous amount of buy-in over the last couple of years. A lot has certainly happened. We have some great speakers, as I said, and we're going to hear from the Volvo Ocean Race and go out in the water, hopefully, if all our technology works here a little bit later in the program. Today is a pivotal moment when we'll be launching World Sailing Sustainability Agenda for 2030 for consultation and unveiling to the world what we plan to achieve in the next 13 years. The Sustainability Agenda 2030 sets out wide-ranging targets over the next 13 years in all areas of World Sailing's operation and influence. Some ambitious targets have been set, and we're going to hear about them today and explore some topics in a little bit more detail and talk about what's happening now and the future. I'm personally very engaged with sustainability, and the reason is I grew up in a small bay, Barnicot Bay, New Jersey, about 50 miles south of New York. And in 1953, a chemical company came and started polluting the water, putting all their refuse in the water of the river. So by 1961, the river was so polluted where I was sailing every day that they closed the river down. Of course, we kept sailing. And their answer was to build a pipeline 12 miles out into the to the ocean, 1,500 yards out, with the idea that the ocean would disperse the polluted substance. That all went well for about 10 years until the pipe broke in the schoolyard where I was going to school. And then it became a Superfund site and billions of dollars were spent cleaning it up. And why I'm so emotional about that story is 100 of my classmates in school all died of some kind of cancer, and I had a 2-year battle with cancer too. So I understand the need for clean water and sustainability. Later in the forum, we'll have a little time for a panel discussion with our speakers, take questions. And yesterday, we had over 1,000 people online participating. We got all kinds of good questions from around the world, and I'm sure we will today. And finally, you can join the debate and conversation by using the hashtag #UnitingOurSport on social media. So with that, we'd like to open up here with a little video on sustainability.
The vision. A world in which millions more people fall in love with sailing, inspired by the unique relationship between sport, technology, and the forces of nature, and that we all work to protect the waters of the world.
I was delighted to be asked to chair the commission. But I think perhaps my experience on the water and having been involved with the industry and the sport for near on 30 years, I think I'm probably in a good place to be able to stand back and separate out the real issues from those that would be nice to have.
I think sport has an opportunity to make a really important contribution to an improved future, and particularly important for the sport of sailing, where nature is the basis of the sport. It's dependent on it, and so the opportunity to bring that into the conversation to improve what we do as a sport for the future of the planet is a really powerful and important thing.
A lot of the issues that came up related really well. They overlapped. Everything from looking at what is in World Sailing's control and what's in their influence, so looking at the events that World Sailing sanctions and making those more sustainable, to boat building and boat maintenance and preventing pollution from the activities of sailing on the natural environment.
When you're thinking as far ahead as 2030, you can really be quite ambitious in your objectives. And I think we've tried to be realistic but ambitious at the same time.
I think where I would like to see World Sailing at is an organisation that has influence around the world across the board on sustainability, so particularly in protecting the marine environment, protecting our waters of the world, and we want to see measurable progress in that.
Sailing is very much dependent on the quality of the water that it occurs on, whether that be in freshwater lakes, rivers, or whether it be on the oceans. And so a really important aspect of what we've been discussing is how sailing can contribute to improved water quality and what that might mean for the planet as a whole.
It's a case of looking at what are the areas of opportunity within world sailing, and ultimately how do we get closer to the source of each of the kind of bigger problems that we're trying to tackle.
And I'm really excited to see a couple of the initiatives that we've come up with that can be put in place that are going to make a tangible difference to a better future.
So much of life at sea is about navigating your way through a shifting environment, and I very much see where we are right now with this new challenge of sustainability. It is forever shifting, opportunities are presenting themselves, and technology is always changing, and it's the same sort of skill set that you need to kind of navigate that territory as well.
I'd like to thank Andy Hunt and all your team at the executive office putting that video together and putting this conference together. Yesterday I got to sit here and witness the women's program, and it was fascinating, emotional, heart-wrenching in a lot of ways, but also uplifting and inspiring. So we hope we get to do that again today. So over the next couple hours here, we have 9 speakers and 8 segments. Each segment will be about 15 minutes long. And like I said, we get some nice surprises along the way, and we'll have some Q&A at the end. So our first 2 speakers are Mike Golding and Dan Redding. Mike Golding, a man that's gone around the world 9 times in both directions, which means he's gone downwind and upwind. So we'll have to get, you have to tell us what you like better, going upwind or downwind, all the way around the world. Mike OBA is chairman of World Sailing Sustainable Commission, and a familiar name to people all over the world with unbelievable amounts of stories. He brings a wealth of knowledge to the Sustainable Commission from an illustrious career in a wide variety of boats. Dan Redding is World Sailing's recently appointed Sustainability Program Manager, coming from almost a decade at the Royal Yachting Association and the British Trade Association. During that time, he was Sustainable Manager for the London 2012 Sailing Olympics, which was a great event. I love being there and had a good time. So today, Dan and Mike will kick off this program by unveiling the eagerly awaited sustainability agenda for 2030. Mike, Dan? All right.
Thank you. Thank you. So good afternoon, everybody. As I've just been introduced, my name is Dan Redding, and I'm the Sustainability Program Manager at World Sailing. I'm absolutely delighted today to be joined by some esteemed speakers, by Mike Golding, who's our Sustainability Chairman, and to unveil our Sustainability Agenda 2030. I thought I would start by reminding ourselves what World Sailing announced last year at the conference in Barcelona. One of the overarching themes was the relationship between sport, nature, and technology. As such, this is the vision of World Sailing, a world in which millions more people fall in love with sailing, inspired by the unique relationship between sport, technology, and the forces of nature. And we all work to protect the waters of the world. We should also remind ourselves of World Sailing's mission that was launched last year as well. Now I'm just going to read out 2 parts, which are linked to today's forum. To make sailing more exciting and accessible for everybody to participate or watch, and to use our reach and influence to create a sustainable future for our sport and the waters of the world. To create a tangible sustainability program that maximizes the positive effect that the sailing community can have on our environment. So now I've just recapped and reminded ourselves of the mission and the vision. Let's have an update of where we are now. So following last year's launch of the sustainability strategy, a commission was established. The commission worked for 2 days, suggesting all the various opportunities that there were relating to sustainability and sailing. These have been documented in the form of our Sustainability Agenda 2030. Finally, in case you're wondering, as Gary mentioned, World Sailing also appointed a Sustainability Program Manager in July, and that's me. The Sustainability Commission has 8 individuals, and they come from 5 countries, and there's a mix of professional sailors, sustainability, event, and industry experts. So after the 2 days of thrashing out what the kind of targets and the objectives should be, this is a document that we're launching today, and it's available to download from our website. It sets out World Sailing's commitment to helping create a better world through sport. I'll talk a little bit now about its content and how sustainability for us is much more than just the environment. The Sustainability Agenda 2030 is comprised of recommendations which represent World Sailing's operational areas. The recommendations each have multiple targets with key delivery dates which address the strategic sustainability objectives. The operational areas which World Sailing will deliver sustainability through are technical standards, events, members, venues and facilities, training and participation. We have independently created our own sustainability targets, but we recognise that they very much support both the International Olympic Committee and the UN Sustainable Development Goals. As an example, we believe that we can contribute to 12 of the 17 UN Sustainable Development Goals through sport. Much more detail on this is in the Sustainability Agenda 2030 that can be downloaded. Here on the screen, you can see that all the Sustainable Development Goals that we support are highlighted. So once the consultation period is over, we will review the targets based on the feedback that we receive and alter the targets if necessary. Once approved, working groups who are experts in specific areas will be formulated. We will also report on our progress annually to the attainment of the targets. So the online consultation is formed of 6 sections and a total of 59 targets. These range hugely in the topic and also the date of their achievement. What we're after is respondents to be able to answer the following for each target on the screen. This will give us an idea of the support for each target as well as feedback that will help with the attainment. We hope that people also take the opportunity to suggest partnerships, existing programs, and examples of where positive action has already been implemented. To summarize, the consultation will be online on this URL, which is on the screen now. It will run for 4 months, so we can get as much feedback as possible from our stakeholders. The consultation will be available in 3 languages, so English, French, and Spanish. And the supporting document can also be downloaded, which gives you much more context about the targets and the links to the UN Sustainable Development Goals. So now we'll run through some of the targets in the 6 different areas, starting with technical standards. We don't have time to cover all of the targets, so we'll just mention a few which are highlighted in pink. And I'd like to hand over to Mike to explain a little bit more.
Thank you. Thanks, Dan. Well, I was delighted to be to accept the role of chairman of the World Sailing Sustainability Commission, but when Andy first came to me with it, the immediate reaction in my mind was, well, why me? Why would I be chosen for this? As a professional sailor, who's primarily campaigned in races that are commercially run and in commercial events for some 25 years, I should be pretty clear from the start that I'm not a sustainability expert. But having sailed hundreds of thousands of miles around the ocean and having sailed on boats like Open 60s, which require us to be very light, the intrinsic job of making an Open 60 light and efficient on a race like the Vendée Globe, an 80-day race, means that you have to limit the amount of fuel you carry because it's weight, limit the amount of waste you carry because it's weight, anything you can do to eliminate weight. So for me, sustainability was a performance enhancement for a Namoka 60. And that is much the way I view it now. I view sustainability as something that actually makes things better. It's not just something, a pain that you have to do in order to run a modern organization. So my role as the chairman is to work alongside and help to coordinate and moderate the commission members who each and all of them are experts and passionate in their individual and respective fields. And my goal is to ensure that every contributing voice is heard, and also that we create a balanced sustainability agenda reaching right the way out to 2030, which is quite a bold statement. As of today, as Dan told us, there are 59 recommendations, which this afternoon we'll share with you, and I'll go through some of them. However, before I begin, I've got just a small anecdote of perhaps my first eye-opener to what we were doing to our oceans, just one part of sustainability. And it's based on a story about an event 17 years ago, the Transat Jacques Vabre, which at that time ran from Le Havre in France to Cartagena in Colombia. And we were enjoying a very good race on a Fino-designed Open 60, one of the early deck spreader-rigged Open 60s. And myself and my co-skipper and friend, Ed Danby, were pushing for it very hard in a podium position of the race. And it was nighttime, there was no moon, we couldn't see anything, we had power on problems on board, so everything was being done by torch. And I changed over the helm, went down below, was just trying to catch a nap, and suddenly the boat decelerated so quickly that I really wondered, I had no idea what was going on, whether we were grounding, but we were some 150 miles off the coast, so that didn't seem likely. But it also, you could feel the whole boat lift up. So I got the strongest torch, went out on deck, cast the torch around us, and again, it's pitch black, and now we're completely stopped in 25 knots of breeze with spinnaker up, bursting at the seams, mainsail pinned up against the rigging, and we are completely and utterly stopped from having surfed at about 20 knots on a huge raft of sticks, plastic, fenders, nets, bottles, single-use bottles, a huge raft. And I mean, this is 19 years ago. We weren't talking about those issues, but 19 years ago, the oceans were creating this kind of thing. But I'd never known any scenario where you actually rode up on it, and we were fully stopped. So as we were still effectively racing, we struggled and fought and kicked to get the spinnaker down and managed to get it down without tearing it. And then we had the mainsail pinned up against the rigging, and we realized if we eased the halyard, the battens would all snap. And we sat there scratching our heads thinking, what is this and how are we going to get out of this? And while we were thinking about it, we started to notice that the whole raft, some 200, 300 meters wide, had begun to rotate. And very, very slowly, this whole raft, all glued together by sticks and branches and so on, slowly, slowly rotated. And we thought, well, hang on, this is all right. It's going the right way, you know. And slowly, this whole raft rotated. And looking behind the boat, I could see the three slots of the keel and the two rudders that had driven into this thing. And we were sitting pretty much smack in the middle of it. Anyway, it took a good while, but the whole raft rotated, and we were able to trim on and sail this huge raft round till it was head to wind, at which point the sails started to flog, and we were able to back down out of the raft and carry on our race. And, you know, 10 minutes later, we had the spinnaker up, and we were off again. But it was an eye-opener. I'd never seen anything like this before, and I immediately started asking questions about it, and the most obvious thing was all the waste, but in fact, it wasn't a complete environmental disaster. What it was stick in the Amazon when there's a drought, or in the big rivers on that coastline when there's a drought, the sticks and twigs that come down the river all clog up in a little gully in the river, and then when they get a flood, they all go out of the mouth of the river in one big rush, and then that big island of sticks goes around collecting up all the bits of waste that are floating in the ocean. But what was astonishing to me was it looked like it was completely waste. And that's 19 years ago, way before we were talking about these issues. So it really opened my eye to it, and it was possibly one of the strangest night sailing that myself and Ed Danby have ever experienced, and both of us have done a lot of miles. So quite an extraordinary experience. The following year, we secured our first major sponsorship with Ecova UK, an environmental cleaning product company based out of Belgium. And that became a 12-year partnership, which began to open my eyes about how big companies could actually make something as nasty as a cleaning product, but do it in an environmental and ethical way. It's an extraordinary company, and I'm not sponsored by them now, I don't have a brand, but it's an extraordinary company, and they do things in the most extraordinary way. More recently, I was sponsored by Gamesa, perhaps the second largest wind turbine company, a competitor to Vestas, of course. And really, my point there is that these companies that are concerned with the issues that are their environmental industries actually want to align themselves with our sport. And to have sustainable top-end sport, you have to have sponsors who want to sign with them. So it's a very attractive sport, and we all know that. And we have to do our best to stay on top of our own sustainability issues, of which there are many. So now to these recommendations. I'm not going to read every single one of the 59. There are pink highlighted sections, which are the areas I'm going to cover. There are many recommendations, 59. But as Dan outlined, it's divided into technical standards, events, training, venues and facilities, members and participation. The recommendations, I'll remind you again, I know Dan did it as well, but I've made notes, so I'm going to keep going. After today, they're not necessarily definitive, and after today, there'll be a further four-month consultation period during which both everyone from within World Sailing and the wider sport can contribute, suggest amendments or additions, such as need be. We're not claiming that we've covered every single base here, but we've made a very good early effort at creating an agenda for 2030. They're not in any particular order, and nor are they prioritized. It's felt by the Commission and by the people, the World Sailing Management that we work with, that to make this work, we really need to tackle all areas with equal vigor and make our wonderful sport altogether better and more sustainable. So on the first slide, covering technical standards, there are 11 targets, and the technical area was really seen as an area where we can influence significant change. To begin with, we looked into developing a reuse program for used equipment from M&As, benefiting emerging nations by 2020. The target could be closely linked with events, as they could provide the platform for when items are collected. We have found that better resource sailing campaigns will have kit that often is thrown away when the sponsor changes. So we're essentially creating a phase two of sponsorship with an established program where sailing equipment and kit is donated to emerging nations that can really use it. Moving on to the next target, it's planned to implement a new sustainability standard which Olympic class equipment manufacturers will have to meet, and world sailing classes and rating manufacturers will be encouraged to adopt by 2024. This will include labour and environmental control standards. For this, we want to ensure that the boats are being built in conditions which are fair for workers and they are in safe environments. We want to ensure that boats we are sailing are constructed in a way which does not cause a detrimental impact to the local environment. We would expect manufacturers to use due diligence and to replicate our expectations through the supply chain. We're setting some tough targets for the boat builders, but we're challenging any new classes that would like to be considered for use in the 2028 Olympic Games to be 90% recyclable. And that will require significant innovation. We'll hear about some of these materials later this afternoon. Finally, we'll specify that all races under World Sailing Classes rules and ratings will not be solely reliant on fossil fuels to produce power on board or for auxiliary drive by 2030. It's an ambitious target, but again, later today we'll hear about how this technology is advancing in the electric boat sector. Pardon me. So events are a key part to what World Sailing does, and they put on their own events, but they also sanction many. So there are clear opportunities to educate and participate and to improve. World Sailing needs to have its own house in order, and we'll follow up on the success of other sailing venues and teams and achieve the Olympic-inspired ISO 20121 standard for sustainable event management, which will be a third-party certified. It's intended to develop sustainability requirements in all bid documents for hosts of World Sailing events by next year. We'll continually improve the criteria so that what we specify in 2018 will be different to what we specify in 2024, as we hope that the needle will have moved in terms of what can be achieved. Learning from and working with some of sailing's mega events, we believe we can eliminate the use of single-use plastics at all our events by 2020, and we'll hear today how this is being rolled out in the Volvo Ocean Race. In the right place? There we go. So we will achieve gender equality at event level at all World Sailing organised events by 2020. We'll also fully integrate the Parasailing World Championships with World Sailing World Championships from 2022. One topic that we received a lot of feedback from is the number of coach boats that attend events. And we'll work with all the parties to achieve a 50% reduction from 2017 numbers at all World Sailing organised Olympic class events by 2024. Additionally, World Sailing will specify that all coach boats and support boats used at their events organised by Olympic class events will not be solely reliant on fossil fuels for propulsion by 2024. It's worth mentioning that all the targets will look to create innovation funds and other resources to make sure that we do not make participation difficult because of expense. But for now, we're looking for support for the targets and work plans for the topics, which could lead to an increased cost, will be open and will ensure that the barriers to participation are not created. And finally, we've set ourselves the target of achieving gender equality for race officials at Olympic and World Cup Championships by 2030. Going on. Okay. Skip along. Training. We acknowledge that the best way to instill sustainable behaviour is through initial introductions to the sport, and that's through training. So these matters deal with training, and the aim is to collate and share the best practice sustainability resources and training programs from other organizations and promote to the M&As and the class associations. There is so much great work being done, and we don't want to reinvent the wheel, but to act as a knowledge and resource hub with organizations who want to share their resources. We'll include modules on sustainability in all World Sailing coaching programs by 2020. We'll ensure that all M&As around the world will have an element of sustainability within their sail training by 2030. There we go, venues and facilities. As a sport, we use a wide variety of facilities when compared to sports hall or stadium. We hope through the use we can help with the sustainable use and development of facilities for sailing. We want to recognise where venues and facilities are operating in a way which supports our Sustainable Agenda 2030, and that's why we will create an award next year. We'll work on providing standards for the construction and operation of sustainable sailing clubs, looking to best practice that exists, ensuring that clubs operate with lower running costs so more money can be invested on boats and supporting grassroots sailing. It's aimed to develop an accessibility standard in partnership with existing standard producers to be used at sailing clubs, venues, and marinas worldwide by 2020. Providing expertise with no cost and reference document which people can use to help with accessibility problems that some facilities face. So there's a huge variety in our targets, and we can only achieve them with the support of the members. This includes class associations and M&As in countries all around the world. So, World Sailing will have a designated member of staff, Dan, to assist M&As and class associations with improving sustainability based on significant sustainability issues by 2018. And the aim is to ensure that sustainability resources are all available in a minimum of 4 languages by 2020. We want the digital resources to be used worldwide so that these will be in different languages. The aim is to create a sustainability charter that all members will sign as a condition of membership by 2018. This will reinforce our collective commitment to addressing sustainability and can be used to share with stakeholders in your own countries. Finally, by 2025, all M&As will have their own sustainability strategy, and we'll work with them to help shape them when needed. The final section is one, of course, which is pivotal to our sport. Something which is common to all of us is the struggle to maintain and increase participation. World Sailing will support existing programs and develop a more universal participation program from M&As to adopt by 2020. This will tackle barriers such as disability, but we need data to begin with, so we need to work out these barriers, and there will be different problems in different countries. And this links to our next target, which is the need to establish areas where work is required and where energy is required, where research is required. And so World Sailing will work with members to research current participation rates by 2019. World Sailing will develop resources and digital tools to better equip its members to develop social inclusion programs and activities by 2020. The world is increasingly going digital, so we can create resources which will contribute to a wider participation in the sport. And of course, we'll work to reinstate sailing into the Paralympics by 2024. Last, but by no means least, is the intention to create a career pathway for women to move into professional sailing, with a target of achieving, well, another way of putting it, doubling the number of professional graded sailors on the Sailor ID platform by 2030, which I think is a pretty ambitious target, but it remains to be seen. So for the full agenda, you can look at the following link, and without further ado, I'll hand over to off again.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Go far.
Thank you.
Okay. Upwind or downwind going around the world?
Oh, you were always going to ask that question.
I'm going to let you off the hook.
Downwind.
Okay, very good.
Okay.
Smart man. Well, thank you very much, Mike. And, you know, your comment there about workers is so important. I've seen many people in the marine industry that worked with fiberglass years ago end up with Parkinson's, and a little known story. In 1962, there was an America's Cup yacht built up in New England, and because of toxic adhesives, all of them died, all the people that worked on the boat. It's a horrible story that happened. All right, well, we're going to go to London for a live leak with Emily Penn. You saw her briefly in the opening video. Emily's an ocean navigator and skipper. She spent the past 10 years leading sailing expeditions to study, expose, and tackle environmental challenges from the tropics to the Arctic with a focus on ocean plastic pollution. We look forward to hear about some of Emily's expeditions and some of the issues that she's witnessed firsthand. And I did a couple ocean races this past summer, long distance races, and I was horrified to see how many balloons, plastic balloons with happy birthday on it, all over the place in Long Island Sound and Chesapeake Bay. So it's a huge issue, and you saw a lot of that. I do like the way the thing spun you around, though. That was pretty good. All right, well, let's go to Emily Penn. Hello, Emily. I could lip sync it. Ah, the beauty of live television. So let me ask our friends in the back, should we come to Emily in a few minutes and go to our next speaker? All right. Emily, thank you very much. We agree with you 100%. All right, we'll try and get back to Emily when we get the sound issue solved. So our next speaker, Damien Foxhall, is currently, how about this, a team member and a sustainability manager at Vestas 11th Hour Racing and joins us fresh off the boat after winning the first leg. Damien's competed in various offshore sailing events and has been a previous Barcelona World Race and Volvo Ocean Race winner. He also previously worked at the Canadian Wildlife Federation. And I was at Sable Island 2 years ago off Canada. What a fascinating place that is all about. And we're going to hear from Damien what it's like to compete at the highest level and how the teams like Vestas are making efforts to be more sustainable. And hopefully, with technology permitting, you'll be able to tell us what's happening with the current team. And I think hopefully you have a surprise for us. Damien.
Thanks very much, Gary. Can everyone hear me okay? Seems like it's working. So that's really unfortunate for actually Emily. I've had the chance to speak to hear her speaking twice over the last few months. So, and she does a really great job of representing in a comprehensive way the issue around marine debris. But hopefully I can touch on that a little bit and maybe we can get her back here with us again. The Volvo Ocean Race has actually chosen ocean health as the sustainability theme, and it's really specifically around ocean plastics and marine debris, so that would have been really good to have Emily, but I'll try to carry the ball for a little while. I'd like to come back to a message that Mike passed on a little while ago, and this is really the sort of title of the talk. We're talking around with 11th hour of the last few days when we're in Lisbon after the boats left and said, okay, well, what's the main message we want to bring across? And I think we decided that actually we wanted to share the current sort of state of play, if you like, within our team and at the Volvo, is that for us, sustainability is not a compromise. On the contrary, it's actually one of our strong points and maybe not the reason we won the first leg, but it certainly may have helped. Sustainability for the Volvo Ocean Race has allowed them to engage a whole range of new partners and new sponsors with a different scope, a new scope, supporting causes within sailing and specifically, of course, outside of sailing as well. And that really has created, I think, a new culture within the Volvo Ocean Race, within the teams themselves, especially the teams that are specifically, have specific sustainable targets, ours included. And the last one there is quite an interesting one as well, some financial savings. So when we think about sustainability, well, that's a compromise. That's going to cost in effort and time and money. We don't have time for that. Well, actually, the opposite is the result of the Evolve Ocean Race and within our own team. In fact, we wouldn't be a team if we didn't have the sustainability partners. How do you make sustainability, how do you make financial savings within sustainability? Well, the Evolve Ocean Race, for the very first time in recent history, the boats are racing around the world for the second time. So I can say that again. The boats are doing the very same race again. There were a couple of new boats built for the race, but for the larger part, these are the very same boats that raced around the world the last time. They didn't buy new boats. Because it's the same class as it was the last time, we don't need 2 years of lead-up time to train on the boats, to work out how to get them working. And actually, most of the teams really only formed and came together 12 months, 6 months, 3 months before the start of the race. That is a huge impact on our carbon footprint, plastic footprint, financial footprint. Going forward, for our own team, Vestas 11th Hour is a combination of two sustainability partners. Of course, Vestas from the previous race. Hopefully, we're going to stay off the rocks this time. A fantastic sponsor, a great team, it's a great opportunity going forward. And combining them with 11th Hour Racing around this theme of ocean health. And basically, it's really sort of created, an ethos or a storyline within our own team around a larger cause and allowed the communications team to have a much more expanded, media story and coverage way beyond the normal, typical coverage of sailing media or even for something like the Volvo Ocean Race, which typically goes far beyond our sailing, our traditional sailing coverage. The three themes within the sustainability strategy for the Volvo Ocean Race of the team are to maximize the impact, to minimize our footprint, and to create a legacy. And so using something like the Volvo Ocean Race, really an iconic sporting event, which reaches all the way around the world, is a fantastic opportunity to sell a story which goes beyond sports. And of course, if you want to tell the story of science, using something like sports is a lot easier, right? Maximizing impact from the event perspective really started off with getting engagement from every one of us involved. So it was actually the teams, the larger Volvo employees, the Volvo event employees, and from the outset, we spent a day together with people like Emily Penn explaining to us the issues around ocean health and ocean debris and marine plastic. And for many of us, we would have been fairly familiar with that. But it was surprising for me to see, how this message was actually quite new for many people. But more importantly, you might know about it, but how can you then integrate that within your own story? And that's something I'll come to a little bit more. About in the middle picture there, that's Mark Towill, one of our co-skippers, and he's at the Ocean Summit. And the Ocean Summit is the Volvo Ocean Race's way of engaging policymakers and government and marine scientists in a platform in each one of the stopovers that we go to. So this one was in Alicante, and the direct impact of that Ocean Summit in Alicante was the mayor signed up to the sustainability charter and is engaged in those for his city going forward. So. Fantastic result. Otherwise, the Volvo Ocean Race, we can recognize the outreach and awareness around the Volvo Ocean Race. It's huge. It goes way beyond the traditional sporting event. Millions of people follow the event. And a lot of people, of course, come through the footfall. It's really significant coming through the various villages and stopovers. So we actually provide, of course, the sustainability ethos is integrated within the products and infrastructure within the race village. So no single-use plastic bottles, no single-use straws, drinking water. All the providers and producers represented within the village have been either vetted or have engaged in sustainable practices. Within our own team, we took a very similar approach. Our team is there to win the race. let me make no mistake. However, we have also decided we want to be the most sustainable team in the event and really lead from the front. So we started off again with team education. We had an amazing opportunity to go to Cambridge, to Cambridge University for sustainable learning. I think Charles Darwin went there, and the Archbishop of Canterbury. So for someone who'd actually never finished school, I thought that was pretty cool to be there studying in Cambridge. I actually got to lecture for about half an hour, so I can say I lectured in Cambridge. But here we are, and it was an amazing university. We learned an awful lot about ocean health, climate change, and really spoke to people who were there on the ground. Specifically, there was one gentleman who spent 17 years down in Antarctica drilling ice cores, and this is one slice of an ice core that Mark's got in his hand. That's a 1,000-year-old bit of ice. And within that bit of ice, there were ice bubbles. There were, as it melted, it was popping, and you could hear the air coming out of the ice. And I turned to the gentleman, I said, "That's time travel." And he was, "You're right, it is exactly time travel." That bit of air that was trapped in there 1,000 years ago was jumping out at that very instant. But that was all in the context of learning, of course, about climate change and the way our climate the way they can track that back hundreds of thousands of years using the ice sheet. On the other side, we have Jenna, and she's our Danish sailor. First time she ever did an offshore race. In fact, had ever slept on a boat was when we did the transatlantic earlier on in the year. But she's an Olympic gold medal winner, recent world champion. And for this was the first time that she sort of really engaged with this idea of sustainability. She said, "I always just consider myself as an athlete. But now I realize that I can actually tell a much louder story or tell a story integrated within my own athletic program, if you like." And then in the middle, that's the exploration zone, which is part of our team base. It brings together, it's like our home. It brings together Vestas and 11th Hour Racing. And that's really the public-facing piece that we have at every stopover, which represents our sponsors, our partners, and most importantly, the ocean health story. Emily would probably speak to this a lot better than I will. And I'm not really here to talk about the why, because I think we all understand that the oceans need our help, and that the way we're going is certainly not the way forward. I'm really here to talk to you about the how and what we're doing as a team in the event. But clearly, I grew up in the southwest coast of Ireland, in a place which was pristine, and it still is when I go home. There's a few beaches which are a little bit littered, but I think, you know, we have as sailors, we have an opportunity to see the world the way it should be. The ocean is blue, the beaches are for more or less clean. But that baseline is actually becoming more and more the abnormal. And for most people, the normal baseline is an urban environment, polluted, littered. And we have an opportunity to represent a correct or a new baseline for people who are really don't have that opportunity. So I think, this is about coming back to Mike's point earlier on about putting the blue back into sailing and into our sailing industry. I've talked a little about the reduction of single-use plastics. And for anyone who speaks Spanish, I think this is refuse straws. So it's all about, of course, refusing, reusing, recycling. In the context of our carbon footprint, our intention for our own team is to calculate and to record our carbon footprint and to offset that, which will be very significant. And that creates a big challenge for something like the Volvo Ocean Race, which has a huge sustainable footprint, as you can imagine. So it starts with some very simple things, personal things. How do I get to work? Where are they going to house me when I'm in Alicante? Is it going to be like the other side of the city? Or I'm going to be able to walk to work. So we visited, and our logistical manager, Amy, she really set it up so that we were able to reduce our carbon footprint because we were traveling less or we were sharing accommodation. Similarly, at the event, what sort of products are we using? Are they going to be organic? Are they going to be sustainably sourced? Are they going to be shipped in from the other side of the world? Some other initiatives, meat-free Mondays, reduces your carbon footprint. With regards to tracking our carbon footprint, it's really significant. You know, if you want to achieve ISO standard 2012-01, is that what it is? Standards, there's a lot of background work that goes into that, weighing all the product that comes in, all the product that goes out, what goes into the landfill, what doesn't, the logistical footprint. So there's a lot of background work that goes into understanding and calculating our carbon footprint. So there is some effort involved in that. It's also an opportunity for us, and especially when you think of something like the Volvo Ocean Race and one of the teams, we have a lot of leverage if we want to, speak and engage with our producers and suppliers. And some of the examples are the sunglasses. These ones came from our supplier in Chile, I believe, and they make sunglasses from upcycled fishing nets. On the other hand, fantastic, iconic marine brand, Musto. And when we first engaged them, I mean, we all know Musto is great gear, and it all comes wrapped up in plastic. A few months after having engaged them, they'd reduced their plastic footprint of their wrapping by more than 70%, just by reducing the size of the bag, a couple of extra folds in the gear, and reducing the weight of the plastic. And that was a direct result of our sustainability program. On the seaside, we also have engaged the Volvo as a way of how can we promote ocean health through, representing the amazing biodiversity that we get to see out there. And so there are two objectives here. One is really to engage the sailors, engage the public, to be able to tell great stories. And we've asked the OBRs, the onboard reporters, to record marine mammal sightings as they go around the world. And that data will then be fed to the scientific community, which actually, increases the data set for the science, for the scientists. And that same data comes back to us in a more valuable way for us, because it allows us to inform the organizers of any potential exclusion zones that might need to be included in the race course. And one obvious one, of course, is off the Nantucket area and Boston area, where the northern right whale population is. Of course, collisions do happen. We try to avoid them. There are other issues around mitigating those, and that's not really the time to talk about them here. But I think I would like to talk very briefly about a protocol that we've been working on for a short while. And it's very simple. At sea, you're obliged to report collisions and hazards at sea to the Coast Guard and to vessels in your vicinity. And there's also, within the merchant shipping industry, it's a fairly well-recognized duty to report collisions at sea, marine mammal collisions at sea, to the International Whaling Commission ship database. And so that's something that we've worked on with the sailing community as well. And that's a confidential process, which in this case, the Volvo Ocean Race organizers are taking on board. Otherwise, the Volvo Ocean Race has always had quite a good science program. And there's a few things we're doing this year. The drifters are again being carried on board. In fact, the boats have them on board this leg, and they're oceanographic meteorological data recorders, which they're going to be throwing off at some stage, somewhere in the middle of the ocean where we don't normally get to. And interestingly enough, of course, that same data is used to reset to reinitialize our weather models. So that same weather models that we're using back on the boat. So that tells quite a nice story. There are a few other science projects that we could talk about, but I would just like to take the time to talk about the education program. And the Volvo Ocean Race this time is a fantastic education program, which is translated into 6 languages. It's curriculum fit, which is designed for teachers and schools to use sailing and ocean health as a way of teaching. So you can use, if you want to teach STEM, language, geography, history, maths, you can do that through the Volvo Ocean Race, and there's a growing demand for that. So it's online for anyone who's interested. From our own side, leaving a positive legacy means the grantee program, and our grantee program is basically at every stopover, we will be using a local organization, conservation or an environmental organization, we will be providing a grant to them and promoting their great work. And this was here in Alicante, in Lisbon. We had the Circular Economy Portugal, which is a great organization which facilitated upcycling and recycling of products and rethinking products as part of the Fab Lab Lisbon. So that's it. There's obviously a lot more to that, so I'll really invite you to go and have a look online at the Volvo Ocean Race sustainability page when you're looking at a tracker, when you have some extra time. Visioning Forward, I think it's a fantastic initiative to be here and to have the opportunity to be part of that. So, you know, good luck to everyone, and I really look forward to being part of that. And just maybe leave you with some wiser words than my own. Thanks very much, guys.
Any other vote? You gonna introduce the vote?
Cool.
I think 1 minute.
1 minute? Okay, I didn't get your... Gary was trying to hold up the sheet for the books ready.
Pretty fancy, okay. Huh?
So I think we've got a live link with the boat. Is that right? Yeah. Yeah. And I believe that Mark Dowell, our one of our co-skippers, is off watch, but Sci-Fi is probably available. So.
Who am I talking to, Dave, man?
All right, we got him.
What's he doing? He's just
say hello.
Hey, is that you, Simon?
Yeah, hi, how are you?
Good. Where are you?
Good.
Have you jibed yet? So tell us, what's it like? How's it going?
It's been a pretty wacky night out here on the ocean. We've been sailing through the trade winds, but there's been loads of clouds, and today has been especially busy with the clouds. It's been like a little mini system that's rolled over us, so I think we sailed through the same patch of water as Dongfeng about 50 minutes later, had a 90 degree difference in wind direction. So no, we're still fast downwind sailing, doing like 20 knots. It's all quite wet on deck, but it's nice, getting warmer slowly. But yeah, really we're sort of trying to line ourselves up for our big push south towards the doldrums, but the wind's been very crazy. There's been big wind shifts, and so there's been some interesting decisions on which way to go, and it's interesting when you get the skeds and you see the boats in all sorts of different winds, so just trying to figure out where everyone's gonna end up.
Yeah, this is ultimately the one moment where you can decide how far west or east you stay or go, right? So are you all still heading west at this stage, or has anyone jibed south yet?
Well, we're sort of doing about 200 heading, which is taking us south, and there's a few boats to the south of us. Obviously, there was a kind of a mixture on the last skid of people going south and people going west, but I think everyone's keen to get west, but they don't want to be the last boat to turn south either, so it's really really quite tricky to make sure you're on the right jibe and going the right way, but also sort of staying ahead of the other boats that you can. We had a kind of a crazy breeze and had 100 wind, so hopefully that might help us out a little bit, but it's hard to say when you don't know what the other guys have got.
So we Gary Jobson's question, how fast are you going at the moment?
We're averaging about 20, so with peak speeds of probably 27, 28. Got the big sails on, triple headed, so as much sailor up as possible. And yeah, we've had everything between, it's sort of settled down at 20. But about 20 minutes ago, we had close to 30, so it's been really quite up and down.
Good, and I don't think I'm speaking out of school here, but
we
saw a sail down below earlier on in the day being repaired. Do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, we had a little bit of damage to the leech on the A3, and we got it down as quickly as we could rather than risk any more damage, and the guys have done a sterling job to fix it all up again, so that one's ready to go as and when we need it. But credit to Stacey, TJ, Tony, Nick, everyone chipped in and got it fixed up in pretty short time, so credit to those guys who've done an awesome job getting it fixed, so it's there when we need it.
Cool, that's great, Sci-Fi. Hey, listen...
harmed us too much, I don't think so.
Okay, so you probably know, of course, we're here at this World Sailing Conference here in Mexico, and actually the day is, and the moment is around sustainability. I know this is kind of fairly key to your own thoughts, so have you got anything to offer us?
Well, no, it's quite good. I haven't seen too much floating around in the ocean, so that's a good thing, I think. We've been... You know, we're into our full normal sustainability program that we have offshore, brushing our teeth with our bamboo toothbrushes, which is great. We've done our meat-free Monday, so that's good. And it's good. It's nice to be making a difference even when we're out here on the open ocean.
Is that Charlie Yen right there on the grinder in front of us?
No, that's Tuny. It's Tuny Bermuda's grinder. TJ's driving, and Stacey's doing the main right now.
Good. Well, thanks for taking the time out, Simon.
And Mark are having a bit of a sleep.
How many people are on deck right now?
We've got three guys on deck right now, and I'll be back up there in a minute.
All right.
So, we can sail the boat pretty comfortably with three when you're in a straight line, but as soon as things get interesting, then you certainly need more.
All right. Well, from Mexico, thank you very much. Gave us all a thrill, and we're all a little jealous. I think everybody sitting in a room would actually rather be out sailing with you right now. But we'll continue to follow the race and have a good rest of the leg. Thank you very much.
Great. Thanks very much. We're certainly enjoying it out here. It's been an interesting race so far, and there's plenty more interesting sailing to come. And we've been enjoying the fast downwind sailing so far. It's going to get lighter from here on in. So we're just still enjoying it while we can, and then it'll get into the sort of tactical game of getting down to the doldrums. So it'll be a fun race to watch, I think. It's going to be an interesting one.
You'll slide right through the doldrums, no problem. I got plenty of confidence. Thanks very much, guys. Appreciate it a lot. That was cool.
Yes. Goodbye. Okay. Have a good evening.
Damien, thank you very much for putting that together. It's kind of cool. Well done. I mean, he sounded pretty calm being on a boat at night, going 20 knots, you know, just, we'll talk to these guys for a few minutes. And how's it going there? You know, it's dark out and sliding along. All right, we're going to talk with Enrico Benko. After doing an America's Cup campaign back in 1992 and over 12 years in London working in the digital media industry, Enrico co-founded Go Sailing for a Change. I love the acronym, GS4C. And their mission is to identify, develop, and promote sustainable solutions for the composite industry in order to foster the adoption of a circular economic model. We caught up with Enrico to ask him what material he's using for his recyclable, how about this, Mini 650. So let's take a look at the video here with Enrico Benko.
The organization is GS4C. We started talking about GS4C, which by the way stands for Go Sailing for Change, in 2010, and then we turned that into a company in 2012. Mission is to promote and foster the adoption of circular economy for the boating industry, which is quite a daunting task. And it's project-based concept. So the idea is that we set ourselves some tasks and some projects, and then we work throughout our professional network to find competences and material to get that task accomplished. We're working with this enriched basalt fiber and bio-based epoxy resin. Both are completely recyclable. So the idea is to work with something that won't be downgraded into some sort of chopped fiber at the end of life, but something that can go back into virgin fiber. We build a boat. We actually build a small mini transat. It's completely made out of this recyclable fiber, and we already run some trials on their older recycling process. What we actually use is enriched basalt fiber. Basalt fiber is basically lava remelted into a lava at melted stage and then stretched into fiber, pretty much as you do with glass fiber. The difference is that with this specific material, it goes through a chemistry analysis before being melted, throughout a balancing of all the chemical components of it. So this allows this to go back into the furnace at the end of life, because the chemistry of the fiber is completely known and is completely consistent throughout all the batches. Uh, Well, it depends on what you consider cost. Even glass fiber has a wide, very wide range of costs. I mean, you can go from the cheapest to up to high-end aerospace-grade glass fiber, which are about $30 a kilo. So what you consider is that the cheapest materials are not recyclable normally. So eventually someone will have to pay the cost for it. Say that we are pretty much on an average, so it's definitely competitive and comparable to normal glass fiber. No. Since the beginning, we wanted something that could be worked out with the same competence that people normally find in boatyards. So it's fabric that gets impregnated. We use infusion, and it goes really well. And I mean, it's the same approach, same working process. We have two ways to recycle it. The specific resin that we use has the option to be separated at the end of life from the fiber. So you can separate the matrix and the fiber at the end of life, and it's a low energy process. Both the fiber and the resin, they have very low embodied energy, which is the energy required to make a kilo of material. And so this is one option, and then we run some trials already, and when we send the fiber back to the fiber manufacturer to verify that it could be re-entered into the furnace. The other option is to go through a pyrolysis process. So this is a fiber that melts at very, very high temperatures, so it comes out of the pyrolysis process pretty much untouched. So you recover the energy of the matrix, and then you send back the fiber to the furnace. Next is definitely, I mean, we learn a lot about this project. So next thing is definitely to start sharing everything we learn so that many people can adopt this solution. And then we're already looking at the next mini translator, which is going to be a full foiling, hopefully, mini translator to show that even high-end top foiling boats can be recycled and sustainable. And then we need some sailing, because it's been too much driving for this project so far.
Alrighty, very good. Did that boat look pretty small to you? All right, we're going to try Emily Penn again. From London, is she there?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yep, Emily, we got about 12 minutes or so of time to share with you here, and we'd like to hear about your expeditions and some of the issues and things that you've seen on your travels around the world. Thank you.
Great, thanks so much, and sorry I can't be down there in Mexico with you. I've been working with Dan and Mike and Andy on the Sustainability Commission to put together the Agenda 2030, and so I'm so glad they got to share that with you already. And what I want to talk about really is some of the work I've been doing, particularly on plastic pollution. And so I'm just going to share up my screen. That should be working.
It is. It's working.
So for me, really, my passion for the ocean began when I was actually hitchhiking around the world to a new job in Australia on board this amazing fuel power boat. We were on a campaign to promote renewable fuels all the way from England to the South Pacific. And it was on this journey that my eyes were really opened to so many of these issues that are going on around the world. And one was being woken in the middle of the night, hearing that scratching sound down the hull of a boat, and coming up on deck to find that we were surrounded by plastic in really one of the most remote parts, at over 1,000 miles from the nearest land. And then we started stopping at these small, and we were finding that the locals were struggling to catch fish because the commercial fishing vessels had emptied their waters of the fish that they knew how to catch. They were struggling to grow food in the ground because that sea level rise had caused their soil to become to sort of knock-on effect of this that I was seeing was then this reliance on importing packaged food and drink that all, of course, came wrapped up in this new strange material. And so I ended up going back to live Tonga in the heart of the South Pacific to try and tackle this plastic issue. While this scene looks like absolute paradise, down on the ground it is a real story. And these communities are really struggling with no system, no place for any of their waste. So it gets dumped on the beach, in the ocean, and often burnt. And it was actually that burning of plastic, that toxic smell that kept getting up my nose, that led me to learn more about these chemicals, these dioxins that are produced when you burn it. And just realizing that this is a really bad situation, these chemicals that lead to cancer, and they're things that we really don't want inside our bodies. And certainly these children living on these little islands didn't either. And so for me, this became my first mission, was to try and remove the plastic, the burning of plastic, and this on these islands. So started working with the local community, but we quickly realized that here, as in many parts of the world, there isn't even the terminology for things like rubbish bin in the local language, because that concept of throwing something away doesn't even exist in the culture, because this plastic material is really so, so new to so many parts of the world. There literally is no system or even way of thinking about dealing with that waste. And so we ended up doing an enormous cleanup project on these little Tongan islands, 6 tons of rubbish in just 5 hours with 3,000 local volunteers. That rubbish then got sorted and cleaned and packaged to be taken away, some to be recycled and other to go to a nearby landfill. And so that time in Tonga, I was dealing really firsthand with this waste issue on a small Pacific island, which we now know is just a sort of small version of what's happening in so many different countries. But I also then started, when I was walking along the beaches, noticing clearly washing up, having travelled a really long distance, often with writing on the packaging labels in languages that I didn't even recognise. And so it was this that got me asking more questions about where that plastic was coming from and why it was landing on these remote little beaches. And so I set off this time to California to start working with some of the oats to understand more about these great big areas of plastic that are actually accumulating in our oceans. And so that's what led to the next few years. But at this point, I still couldn't quite get my head around why there was all this plastic in the ocean in the first place. So I started to learn a little bit more about the material plastic itself, discovered that it actually 50,000 plastic bags in our world every 3 seconds. And those bags, they get used once, maybe twice, probably 3 times at best. And then they get thrown away. And I was realizing that this material, plastic, we use it to make things, design things that are designed to be used just once, like a bag or a bottle, and then thrown away. Out of a material that's designed to last forever and ever. And it's really science and product design that puts us in this situation of having so much waste with no. So then I thought, we can maybe recycle that plastic. Can't we just turn it back into new things? Turns out that actually only between 5 and 10% of all the plastic we use actually gets recycled. And that number's so low because really plastic is a name that we give to hundreds of different materials that all have different properties and different chemical structures. And it's very hard to sort and separate that waste to be able to recycle it into a high quality product. So as it turns out, there's a huge amount of this plastic that really has no use, no value. And so it's not that surprising that much of it escapes landfill or doesn't have a landfill at all, and making its way down streams and drains and rivers. And ultimately, everything runs downhill to the ocean. This image here is in Los Angeles, a city which has a pretty great waste management system. And yet, this is still how much plastic is entering into the ocean. And then you've got somewhere like in coastal communities all over the world. So then the question is, where does it go and how does it move? So when it leaves land, it then meets those ocean currents. We have that great big clockwise rotation in each of our northern hemispheres and anti-clockwise in each of the southern hemispheres. And in the middle, the calm patch, the high, we in the science world call these gyres, these accumulation zones. And anything, whether it's seaweed or plastic, is going to want to move towards the middle of those accumulation zones. So they end up being at around 20 to 40 degrees, both north and south of the equator. And so we end up with five of these hotspots around the world. And so this here was actually the result of a computer model by a scientist in 2008. But at the time, only the North Pacific patch, as it's known, was the one that had actually been discovered. So for me, back in 2009, this became my next mission, was to go out to those other four gyres and find out if they even existed, if there was plastic there or not. And so for this new project, Sea Dragon, which is one of the old Challenge 72 steel yachts that was built to race around the world in the wrong direction, and we managed to get enough funds together to buy this boat, and have been really sailing it all over the world ever since, doing this scientific research, mostly looking at plastics. And along the way, taking with us of people, 10 new guest crew join a voyage on every leg, a mix of scientists, filmmakers, journalists, educators, to go out and see this problem. And when we first got out there and started fishing up these bits of plastic in the middle of these gyres, really this is all we managed to find in one of the densest spots in our ocean. And so it wasn't quite stacking up, given that we knew 8 million tons of plastic was going in every year. And so we quickly realized what was happening, and that actually these big bits of plastic break down into tiny fragments, what we call microplastics, smaller than your little fingernail. And you can't see the microplastics when you look at the water, but when you then deploy the manta trawl net over the side of the boat and drag that net along the surface of the ocean with a very fine mesh, we then pull it back on board, turn the socket to a sieve, and that's where we then find these hundreds of tiny fragments of plastic. And what we realize now is that most of the plastic in our ocean is actually this big. It's so small that you can't see it from satellite image from space. You can't see it when you're sailing along, but it's actually like a fine soup that's now covering the whole surface of the planet. So we these next couple of years crisscrossing our way all over the globe, going to each of these gyres, and sadly, everywhere we went, we found the same thing. And not only in the middle of these gyres, but everywhere in between just has less, really. But the plastic's still there. When we get those samples on, we have to analyze them. We have to work out what's plastic and what's plankton. And it turns out in this image that those two pieces there are actually plastic. And so we realize how hard it is for the fish to distinguish the difference between their food, the poison, and this plastic. So when we start catching fish, we then found things like this rainbow runner that actually had 17 fragments of plastic inside its stomach. And so this, for us on the science team, really kind of shifted the focus of the work. And the fact that we know that plastic and other chemicals are getting into the food chain, we are at the top of. And it moved the focus of the research not only onto the physical presence of this plastic in our oceans, but what it might mean for us and other species that live on our planet, and chemically as well, and whether there's a chance that that's actually reaching us at the top of the food chain. And when we did some blood studies to actually look at what we have got inside us, this was a couple of years ago, I discovered that actually I have 29 of these 35 chemicals that we tested for inside my body. And it turns out that we all have this body burden, these synthetic chemicals within us that really shouldn't be there. And so we continue these voyages, really looking for more answers. At this quite significant moment, that moment when you finally reach land after a month at sea doing this work, this moment has become more and more significant for me, because the more time I spend out at sea, the more I realise that the solutions to this plastic, toxic and other pollution issue, they all start right here on land. And so much of the work now is moving to what it is that we can do about it. And obviously, because the problem starts with us, so does the solution. And so we're looking at ways that we can get from down the bottom there at the ocean, where we're seeing this plastic, all the way up to the source of this problem, as close to the source as we can get. So, you know, at level, we need to think about how we can minimize the damage that plastic out there, is already causing. But better still, we need to look how we use these ocean plastic materials, again, before the end of its waste, whether that's turning it into energy or turning it into something like a shoe, as Adidas are doing. Better still than that, we can look at how we can close the loop so we don't have waste at all, and looking at all sorts of ways that we can actually design a circular economy, or even just avoiding using that plastic in the first place and going for legislative bans and alternatives to the material. As I mentioned, so much of this work, it happens on land, and many of our projects now are really focusing on what is that impact that is particularly these sailors who go out and see the issue firsthand, what can they bring back and what change can they instigate. That we've been doing with our own sailing community for a few years, and more recently started with Volvo Ocean Race about this idea of how sailors and athletes can become a voice for the ocean as well. And as part of 11th Hour project, we've actually been delivering sustainability training to the athletes on the Volvo Ocean Race team and previously the America's Cup team, the Ben Ainslie America's Cup team. So looking at ways that the sailing community can be part of it in that way as well. And also resources, toolkits, so that there's basically better access for people who want to become spokespeople and advocates on the air. But really, there is so much more that we can do as well. As you heard from I'm just going to stop sharing my screen there now. As you heard earlier with the work on the Agenda 2030, it's everything from boat design to events to working directly with members and sailors. There's really at every point of the spectrum from source to ocean. As a sailing community, we can be working together to be part of the plastic problem solution, and also many other ocean challenges out there as well. So I hope that you get a chance to really have a look at that document that's been put together, have a read through, and I really look forward to working with World Sailing on implementing it in the coming years. Thank you.
Thank you, Emily. Thank you very much. And thanks for staying up late at night here for us. So we're glad we got to hear from you. It was a wonderful presentation.
I hope you have a great afternoon.
All right, our next speaker is Todd Sims. Todd spent 23 years in the IT industry. Todd, I think you saw a lot of changes during that time in both technical and sales positions. He then owned and operated E-Power Marine for 8 years, an independent boat dealership located in South Florida. We're going to be there next year in Sarasota, specializing in electronic propulsion. In 2014, he joined Torquedo, the world's leader in electric propulsion. Todd is a U.S. Coast Guard captain, and he can shed some light on the range of electric options for different boats. I have a really nifty 32-foot day sailor, and it has electric motor, so I bought in myself. Excellent. Todd Sims.
Thanks, Gary. And thank you for the endorsement of the technology, Gary.
That's great.
Yeah. So a couple of disclosures before I get into the material. I am certainly the least experienced sailor in this room, although I did grow up also sailing in Barnegat Harbor there, sunfishes, and chartered a few times. And race J24 is a little bit as well, so it's not unfamiliar to me. The second disclosure is I do report to the sales team within Torquedo, so we're going to see some product information, some corporate information, but it's still all relevant to the topic at hand. So sustainability, of course, is not one thing. It's a continuation of efforts by many associations, peoples, companies. We hope that our contribution helps move the dial and convert more to the electric propulsion world in the marine environment, which is what's happening in the over-the-road environment as well. So a little bit about Torquedo. We are the leader in electric propulsion within our power range, which is from 1 horsepower up to 80 horsepower. We've sold 70,000 units worldwide in 55 countries, and that is in a 12-year period. So, founded in 2005, a little beautiful place south of Munich called Lake Starnberg. This is a lake that is regulated, does not allow any combustion motors. Two brilliant guys, a marketing guy and an engineer, kind of got together and said, we've got to find a better solution to this, to everyone using underpowered trolling motors and homemade electric propulsion systems, and that really was the birth of Torquedo, not in a garage, but in a boathouse. So we'll go through the systems pretty quickly, and then some applications more towards the end of the presentation. We have basically a low voltage product line and a high voltage product line. The pod motor systems and the cruise outboards make up the low voltage product line. That comes in a 2 kilowatt, a 4 kilowatt, and a 10 kilowatt power level. So this is the equivalent of about 5 horsepower to 20 horsepower in the combustion motors. This is a schematic of a complete low voltage system. So understand that the way these things work together, it's very componentized, it's very modularized. So essentially, it's a scalable system. This is a full system showing a low voltage hybrid. It could be a pod, it could be an outboard, but this could be as simple as simply the motor in the bottom left and a single battery and a throttle and a small instrument display screen. So understand, some of our customers start out with a very small system like that. They add functionality. For instance, the solar charging can be added at a later date. You can add battery capacity at a later date for additional range, or a diesel generator if the application requires that you can't generate your own electricity for some reason. Perhaps somewhere that has no access to shore power charging, so a diesel generator might be an option there. And then we also have some different interface options that I'll go through. This system, as a complete system, last year won the Dame Award at METS, which is coming up next week. So, you know, why do you want to consider electric power? Five things to highlight here. Of course, sustainable. Lightweight in the lower power categories. The weight depends on the battery in many cases. Cost effective in many cases, certainly in the lower power categories. It's a different user experience, and that is convenience and maintenance type things. I'll get into detail on all of these things. Also, as I said, very modularized and scalable. Therefore, you can add to the system fairly easily. So the first item here, sustainable. Of course, when you're running a pure electric system, there are no emissions at the point of use, right? So we have to generate electricity somehow to charge your batteries. But in a sailing environment, you could certainly do that through hydro generation, while sailing, generating your own electricity by spinning the propeller, as well as solar power. Shore power in many cases is not that bad plugging into shore power. That could be from a hydroelectric plant as well. Many power plants are pretty tightly regulated and do produce fairly clean power. Of course, not all of them do, but so at the point of use, we've got zero emissions. There's no oil, there's no exhaust, there's no noise pollution as well. So the systems are small and lightweight, typically under the hull, that is. The actual motors themselves in the lower power category are very small. We're hardly adding any drag to the boat compared to, this was a test boat, about a 12-meter sailboat. At a 6 to 7 knot speed, we saw a decrease in practically nothing, 0.4 knots decrease there. So this means that you can use this without any real penalty in terms of you know, hydrodynamic penalty. Again, lightweight and small, not only underneath the wetted surface, but the components themselves. So what I have up here is a comparison between a combustion motor and an electric motor, complete with batteries, chargers, the whole deal. So this is a 6.7 kilowatt combustion motor. So we're comparing this to our four kilowatt, roughly about 8 horsepower there, electric motor. You see we come out less than half the weight. One reason why I can compare a 6.7 kilowatt combustion motor with a 4 kilowatt electric motor is the difference in how the motors develop torque. So we have basically a flat torque curve, which means we can fit the motor with a much larger propeller, which would stall a combustion motor in many cases at low RPM. Yet at 1 RPM, my electric motor has the same amount of torque available as that combustion motor at maybe 2,000 RPM. So that is really a big difference in terms of, that's the explanation as to why we can compare electric at a lower level with combustion at a higher level. This advantage does start to go away as we go up the power curve. So as we get to the 80 and 100 horsepower motors, since in most cases we're using similar propellers at that level, that disparity in power starts to kind of fade out. So number three, cost effective. This also is more prevalent at the lower horsepower level. So this is just a couple of data points there. A cruise 2.0 with battery, charger, complete system, runs about $7,000 USD in that's a retail price. The the 10 kilowatt, which is equivalent to about a 20 horsepower diesel, about 23,000 retail price. So if you actually do a total cost of installation, if you really look at repowering a diesel and you've got a lot of other ancillary supporting components that also have to be purchased, we might have an advantage at the acquisition price, but we certainly have an advantage with the maintenance and the ongoing cost of a combustion system. So fuel, maybe you don't use that much fuel, maybe you don't use your engine too much, but certainly maintenance cost is something that really needs to be looked at as a total cost of ownership. These systems, the batteries can easily last 5, 8, in some cases longer, years. And on the motor side, there's really no annualized service regimen that has to be paid for year after year. So user experience, most of us with a small diesel or even a small outboard, in the case of a small outboard, really have no instrumentation. You might have a throttle, that's about it. Maybe a gas gauge, maybe it works, maybe it doesn't. The type of information that you get from an electric propulsion system, much more detailed, much more accurate. So here's an example of we're using a B&G Zeus screen on the bottom left. This is an optional screen that can be used on any of our systems. The upper right is one of our new throttle designs. We have multiple optional throttles. They also have small screens if you don't have a spot for the large Zeus screen. The point is the data that you get through the screen, operational data like speed and battery capacity and that sort of thing, but also detailed information about your system, the temperature of the motor, the temperature of the battery, what's going on with the charger if you're plugged into to shore power. It's really a different experience. You know a lot more about what's going on with the system. Also, if you have problems, this is also how you would get your error code information. These systems can be updated in some cases remotely via a Wi-Fi link if there's a software issue. So it's really a complete kind of different user experience. So of course it has to connect to your smartphone. That's a requirement these days. So one thing you can use is our Bluetooth application called Torque Track. All of our systems have a range calculator built into the system, so a GPS-based miles till empty or hours to empty, if you will, depending on how fast you're going, the current, the wind, if you're getting pushed back, of course. It's a very accurate representation of how far you can still go. You'll find out very quickly that adjusting the speed in small increments has a huge, huge difference on range. In some cases, one knot of speed lower might double your range, and of course, one knot of speed faster might half your range. But you have all of that data right here. So on the Torque Track phone application, we use a Google Maps or a downloadable map overlay with a range circle that's expanding and contracting depending on how fast you're going and what the weather conditions are. So don't underestimate the convenience factor. So we've talked about some of the comparisons between combustion and electric, but some of the things as you're using the product, the quietness on board is something that everyone particularly loves, especially sailors appreciate that. The no smell, the no exhaust, the no dealing and storing with fuels, going to the fuel dock or the gas station to fill up small cans. You don't have to worry about storage of all of that mess and what happens if it spills, of course. As a matter of fact, the number one reason why our small travel outboard is the big seller as a tender motor is because it's going as a into a yacht with a large diesel. They don't have gas on board. They don't want to carry gas on board. So the electric is a great option for them. So I said that these are modular and you can expand on these systems. That also extends to our customers. So this is a picture of the Hansa 315, which uses a rudder by Jeffa. So Hansa, Jeffa, and Torquedo collaborated on installing the pod motor that I showed you earlier into the rudder. This basically changes the game on how you can maneuver and dock a boat of this size. There's a great video on YouTube that I encourage you to search and see how maneuverable this vessel is. They brought this project to us, and we're working with a lot of other manufacturers and other kind of unique projects like this. So I'm going to speed it up a little bit. The battery is the heart of all of our systems. This is our low voltage battery. It's made up of 18650 lithium cells. We could spend 2 hours talking about lithium chemistries. All I'll tell you is it's a lithium NMC, which has the highest energy density in the smallest package. We've sold more lithium into the marine world than any other company. Okay, so moving, that was all low voltage stuff. Moving into the high voltage world, our 80 horsepower motors, 100 horsepower peak. This is a nice gunboat 60 that we used for a test platform for a very long time. The thing to understand about these large yachts with electric propulsion or hybrid systems is that the house loads, the daily house loads can actually outpace the propulsion loads. Typically they're sailing all day, they come back to the harbor, put the hook out, and now the loads really start. They turn on the air conditioning, they turn on all of these other loads, entertainment systems, and over the period of 24 hours, they could easily use two or three times the amount of capacity that they used to actually push the boat. So of course, we designed the system to handle that load. Little schematic of all of the components. I just want to point out the fact that this is a high voltage system, but we have multiple voltages as part of the system. We're providing all of the electrical capacity that you need on a vessel like this. 12 volt, 24 volt DC for your low voltage direct loads, pumps, navigation, that sort of thing. On the high end, of course, we're running inverters off of our high voltage batteries, so 120 volt, 240 volt AC. It's all coming off one system, only one system to manage, one screen, essentially, with all of that information on it. Speaking of screens, real quickly, this is an example of some of the detailed screens that come with the system. One thing this doesn't show is we can drill down at the component level, look at the motor, for instance, find out exactly the temperature, the rotation, detailed information, the software level. And my favorite I call it the boat at a glance view. All of the red arrows are consumers. All of the green arrows are producers. So I'm using fuel to run my generator, which is then going into the batteries, which is then being used by the electric motors. Just a quick example of the kind of detail that you get from these instruments. And that's all in real time. So this is our partnership with BMW. We use both the i3 and the i8 batteries in the high voltage system. BMW has sold 80,000 units of the i3 cars. It's got a great safety and reliability track record, and now we bring it to the marine industry. So what's sailing without tenders and other type of support boats? The small travel motor, which is about a 4-knot, 5-knot motor. You need to go a little faster. You step up to the cruise system. So this will plane a 4-meter four-meter dinghy with a couple of people in it. A little faster than that is the cruise 10 kilowatt for small ribs. And then something that is pretty cool and pretty new. So this was launched 2 months ago at the Cannes show. This is a collaboration between Torquedo and Avon. This is a 80 horsepower E-Jet, they call it. High voltage batteries hidden there under the front console and all the way forward. Not in production yet, but Avon has very high expectations for this model. This is a little bit of Avon's announcement. It's the convenience. It's about getting rid of the gas, the reliability issues, the maintenance issues, and all of those things that go along with that. A couple more pictures of the E-Jet, the actual jet unit itself. We're able to direct drive that with a high RPM electric motor, so that was a customization on our part. And there's the helm. I think I've got one. There's under the hood. So on the right-hand side there, you see our motor controller, and the black rectangle is one of the lithium batteries. The components of the high voltage system laid out here, pretty similar to the low voltage system. Battery is always centric to the design. Then we can size the chargers, we can size the motor, and the other peripherals for whatever you need. Yeah, a couple more ribs. So this might be suitable for coaching applications, for committee boats. This is actually an old boat. We had this in 2011 at the Miami show. So none of this is really super new this year, except for the E-Jet. Fleets of these boats can be monitored centrally, and that's part of the standard functionality of the system. That boat had our old batteries in it, and that's why it's kind of so large. So, and if you need the ultimate, then you just put twins on. So now this is a 160 horsepower rib with multiple batteries and a lot of range. And I think we're out of time. Thank you.
Dan, I think we've seen the future of coach boats. Look pretty cool. Next up, we have Martin Wadhams. He's the chairman of RS. He's raced all kinds of boats, certainly his classes, won a number of nationals. And anyway, he's going to tell us a little bit on video here what RS is currently doing at their boat building facility.
Well, firstly, let me start by apologizing for not being there in Puerto Vallarta for the forum this morning. I'm actually on the way as you watch this, and I'll be there from Wednesday morning, so I look forward to catching up with many of you then. And secondly, the thing I'd like to say is, look, I don't consider myself an expert in sustainability. So, you know, my apologies in advance if I say something that's out of date or just plain wrong, but maybe the point of this is that, you know, RS Sailing got stuck into the sustainability topic and, you know, without starting out as experts. We'd like to feel we've created some great boats for kind of future generations, and it feels right for us to be focusing on the environment going forward. And this time last year at the Sustainability Forum, we looked, we listened, and went away, and it inspired us to go away, actually turn some of what we were doing into a plan, but build on it massively, and develop our sustainability project from there. So in terms of World Sailing and what's happened since then and the agenda, well, I think it's great to see how some really expert people have become involved. I think the agenda that World Sailing have created and the team have created appears broad. I think it's very challenging in some areas, and maybe some of those specific targets will need a bit of sort of deeper investigation as to the actual definition and extent behind them to make sure that they're realistic. It's comprehensive, it's broad, it's challenging, so I think that's all good. And if it's inspired people like us to give more focus to sustainability, well, I completely applaud it. Okay, there are a number of key sustainability challenges for a boat builder, clearly. And I think it's worth saying that overall we think this is one of those jobs that will never be done. It's a project, an agenda that we see as rolling on, and we'll just continue to knock the corners off the square and hopefully eventually end up with a circle. So in starting this, what we did was break it for our business into two main areas. First one being the boats themselves, and the second one being our company's operations and that of the class associations and events as well. So boats and operations. With the boats, I would say the challenges that we identified have centred around staying up to date with recycling opportunities, assisting and even leading if the opportunity is there, designing in sustainable aspects from the outside of boat development, manufacturing efficiency, reducing waste, working out how we can use more sustainable materials in our manufacturing in the future, and making people aware of the recycling opportunities of the products that we produce, so how to go about recycling, in fact. And then on the operational side, we broke that into reducing waste and recycling, improving packaging, or reducing packaging, but improving the materials where we could, improving transport efficiency, and reducing energy consumption, etc. So those things are kind of common, I guess, to any business. The first steps that we took on the way to becoming more sustainable were different for our different production systems. I guess we use two systems of hull manufacture: rotor molded, which is generally used for the training and the recreational junior end boats, and we use GRP composite for the lighter, higher performance boats. And those have very different properties, very different approach, from sustainability perspective. Looking at the rotor moulding first, rotor moulded polyethylene can be recycled. So, that's a pretty big tick. 70% of the boats that we produce, therefore, can be recycled. And if you add in the fact that many of the other components are metal, over 90% by weight of, say, an RS Fever or an RS Terror or many of our other training boats can be recycled. But the thing we quickly realised there was that we knew that, but most of the world didn't. We weren't telling anyone, so that opportunity was largely being missed. So part of the sort of strategy around the rotor molded boats was to improve the awareness. I should perhaps just quickly explain that the way that can be recycled is that a polyethylene boat can be effectively ground, the material can be ground back down into powder, reused for making other products. It can't be reused for making another boat because we use top-end materials. It's lower grade when it's been recycled, but it can be used for making water tanks, truck bumpers, all that kind of stuff. We've now labelled all the boats. We've highlighted the recyclability to RS dealers internationally, put information on our website, and we have an ongoing programme to try to make the world aware of those opportunities. And we've also encouraged RS dealers in various parts of the world to try and locate where those recycling facilities may exist in their part of the world and be able to help direct people to that. So that's rotor molded. GRP is a lot more challenging in terms of recycling. Currently, and I think this is evolving all the time, maybe somebody else speaking at this forum will make what I'm saying obsolete, and I hope they do. But currently, as we understand it, the recycling options are limited and they're not cost efficient. So the material that's produced from, the job of recycling, the material that's produced isn't worth the cost of what it takes to do it. So those facilities are quite few and far between. And even if you're prepared to pay, certainly in the UK, they're just not generally available. So we have to kind of tackle that problem in other ways with GRP composite. It is worth mentioning that with carbon fibre structures, that's actually the opportunities are a bit greater because the residual product, the actual carbon that can be reclaimed, has such a higher value. So there are more opportunities, and I think those opportunities are developing faster. So we're kind of onto that. Yeah, we have and increasingly are designing in features related to sustainability matters. And I can give a number of examples. You know, we've always set out to make our boats as light as possible within the constraints of durability for the sector that the boat's in. But, you know, I'm stood here next to the relatively new RS Aero, where we've absolutely taken that to a whole new level. The Aero is a similar size to, say, a standard laser, and it weighs more or less the same as an Optimist. So, you know, you have to really dwell on that a moment because, you know, it's a full-size boat, weighs the same as an Optimist. It's extraordinarily light, and that's been achieved through the structural design shape, incorporating where relevant high-tech materials, simplicity, and absolutely designing out any areas that would lead to wasted weight. So the result of that is that you have a boat that's not only, you know, fantastically engaging to sail, and, you know, it's almost a pleasure to pull it up the slipway or lift it onto the roof of a car. So it's great for the sailing end, but it's actually, you could say, you know, if it's only using half the amount of GRP materials of a similar size boat, it's actually, you know, halved the problem in the first place. Then there are many features within the boat itself. For example, the deck shape was designed to allow the boats to stack one on top of the other without needing framing or anything that uses up space. So that enables some real benefits in terms of transport. You know, for example, four guys going off to an event can just stack their boats up behind a normal size car, all go in one car together, and you know, minimize the footprint of that travel. Because the boats stack so efficiently, closely together, you get more boats in a shipping container or on a truck, and that means at the point of distributing the boats, when they're new, the freight is more efficient, and likewise for travel to events, freight's more efficient. So again, you know, it's a proper win-win. The cost is reduced and it's better for the planet. And then there's a number of other, you know, details which are important details. You know, we designed into the cockpit shape a reusable water bottle holder, and we supply every boat with that water bottle just to absolutely encourage people not to be using single-use bottles. So those are just a few examples, but I suppose it illustrates how when you start out with that goal in the development stage, there are many things that you can achieve. And what we did with the Aero is we actually put those things kind of front and center on the design goals for the boat, because otherwise it's all too easy for elements like that to get lost when the conflict of design development outcomes kick in later. So we made sure that those things weren't, you know, didn't drift away through the development process.
I think every car built in America now has drink holders, so putting on boats, even Olympic boats, has some merit to it, the way that was sold. Very good. Hey, look, I'm sure a lot of your colleagues have finished up their various meetings, and feel free to send a text to come in and hear our last two speakers and our panel discussion here in a few minutes. So Klaus Nartrup is a great sailor, 470s, 505s, and he's using that to run the Hampel Sailing World Championship, which we're looking forward to. And they've been doing some sustainability initiatives there coming up for the Hampel Sailing World Championship. So Klaus, why don't you tell us a little bit about it? Welcome.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for the opportunity for being here today and sharing our ambitions and desire to use the Sailing World Championships to bring forward the sustainable agenda. I'm honored to be here in this great company, sharing with people sharing the same passion for the sport of sailing and the strong will to protect our waters and nature. I think the whys, they are quite obvious, so we'll focus on the hows. There are a lot of them to take care of, and we'll focus on those where we can actually influence. The Hempel Sailing World Championships, they will reach out to 100 nations taking part in the competition, attract thousands of spectators, and worldwide streaming and broadcast will bring the competitions into a million of households all over the world. This makes the event an important platform and a great opportunity to work actively with the sustainable agenda. And it's our clear ambition that the Sailing World Championships in 2018 will leave a positive footprint on the global sustainability. The world will look to Aarhus in August 2018, and we will use this opportunity to raise the awareness of the increasing pollution of the oceans. Managing this at an event where the success of the event organizers also is measured by the performance on the race course, the onshore logistics, the spectator experience, we realized that for performing well also on sustainability, we need first of all to ensure that we are applying the best practices already in place and common to the local community. But in addition to this, we also want to add specific visible initiatives. For this, we have been looking for the right partners, helping us to set the path, but equally important also to get it done. A specific initiative that we launched at the World's Test Event earlier this year is a waste management system that will allow athletes and their support teams to collect their waste right in the middle of the action. The feedback has been great, and we strongly believe in this to make a difference. I'll get back to this later. Another important topic is drinking water. In Denmark, we favor of having pure drinking water, very high quality. So nobody actually needs to bring plastic bottled drinking water to Aarhus next year. This is a very important message. The list of opportunities may be endless, and the event offers many different platforms for informing, educating, and entertaining on sustainability. Our core objective is, of course, to deliver a venue and a field of play for world-class sailing and a maritime festival entertaining and exciting hundreds of thousands of people. To succeed in making a clear mark on sustainability also, realizing that we are not experts in this area, we are engaging in partnerships with strong actors who share our involvement and eager to use sailing world, using the Sailing World Championships as an arena for their sustainable messages and initiatives. Our partnerships, they range from organizations having sustainability as their core mission to public institutions within education and infrastructure. World Perfect, a local agency working with sustainability since 2010, plays a very special role as we have included them into the event team, giving them the task of project managing the specific initiatives on sustainability. World Perfect is currently sustainability operator for the Aarhus European Capital of Culture 2017. And in this way, they're very closely connected to the city of Aarhus, and this is indeed a very important fact and a big advantage. World Perfect, they are playing an important role in tying together sustainability across all our management areas. If we really are to encourage all athletes and coaches to collect and sort the waste offshore, we'll of course have to make sure that it's managed properly when brought ashore. A key responsibility of World Perfect is to facilitate that all our sustainability initiatives actually will work back to back. We believe that basically everybody wants to do the right thing. The trick is to make the right thing the most convenient thing to do. We would really like to launch the Sailing World Championships in Aarhus next year as a 100% sustainable event, but it wouldn't be real. One can always argue if we are ambitious enough, but we have a clear ambition of putting a lasting mark and raising the bar for the events to come. Allowing one step at a time, it would lead us towards what we all want, sustainable events. Looking at the global sustainability goals and development goals, I will take you through the opportunities we see. Denmark is at the leading edge if it comes to wind turbines. 2015 was a record-breaking year in Denmark when wind supplied more than 40% of the electricity, looking at over an entire year. Even more for Aarhus, it Aarhus was fully supplied by wind-made electricity for close to 1,500 hours. In Denmark, wind energy is the obvious choice if it comes to electricity. I told you about the drinking water. We have very clean drinking water. The purity and quality of tap water in Denmark often beats even expensive, high-quality bottled water. For decades, this fortune has been taken for granted, but it may not be in the future. In collaboration with the local water supply, we will share the message of this value of having high-quality drinking water and how to guard and preserve this fortune. We do have the clean and pure water, and we will provide it to the athletes for free, of course, but we're still looking for the right partnerships to brand and give away reusable drinking bottles, helping to reduce the single-use plastic. Another topic is about food. Food has a great impact on the personal well-being, as well as on the environment and nature. At the Worlds, we will provide a variety of different food stands, serving the various desires of the participants and visitors. We will strictly govern the origin and quality of the food, and our waste management will be focusing on reducing food waste and increasing recycling. This is contract managed. If a partner would like to showcase sustainability initiatives, for instance, plastic-free circuits, our food partners, they will be ready for this. Bikes and public transportation. Having an event like the Sailing World Championships in the center of a city like Aarhus does make the need for bicycling and public transportation self-evident. Aarhus is a bicycling city, and you'll quickly appreciate the ease and speed of using the tram or riding your own bike instead of struggling in your car. Public transport and bicycle lanes are designed into the new emergent city of the Aarhus Harbourfront, and we will encourage all participants and visitors to take advantage of this. We have the opportunity to attract thousands of sailing enthusiasts, thousands of spectators and their families. Besides presenting Olympic sailing at its highest level, our objective is to entertain, inform and educate. We have partners who specialize in informing on maritime wildlife and educating good sustainable behavior, and others who want to use the event as a platform to showcase their specific programs. For instance, we are collaborating with the Naval Environmental Patrol run by the Danish Navy. They have been successful in engaging the entire Danish population, not only sailors, in guarding the seas and coastlines against waste and pollution. Our city activity program of the event will have a clear and loud message on sustainability. Key to a good sustainable behavior is to make sure that we do not leave anything in nature that doesn't belong there. Appreciating that the teams have only one focus to win the competitions, we want to present a system that makes good waste management actually the most convenient way of getting rid of waste with only seconds to the next gun. We were aiming at introducing a system that allows the coaches to collect waste from the teams and easily sort and store it in a safe compartment attached to the rib. Back on shore, the coach should find dropping stations right at the mooring, matching the collected waste fragments. Besides keeping the rib tidy, it must make the right thing to do, a very convenient thing to do. We interviewed coaches on what systems actually would be helpful. And together we came up with the system that I will present to you in a video. Please show my video.
The project that we're doing in cooperation with the World Sailing Championship is about waste management and waste sorting in boats. We've designed this bag to fit for the trainer boats. We put the system in the coach boats because the sailors don't have the ability or don't have the time to sort their waste in their boats. So the trainers, of course, has to take this responsibility.
So every day on the water, between races, the sailors come up to my rib, load off trash, basically. They drink, they eat, and they have energy bars during the day, which means that my rib is basically loaded up with trash. This system is now helping to actually select and to store the trash, and it prevents the trash from going into the water, and therefore it's also good for the environment.
We're doing a test for the whole system. Some of the adjustments that we need to do is to figure out how to secure the bag even more in the boats. One other adjustment is, of course, to figure out if we picked out the right waste types for the coaches to sort.
I think it's very user-friendly. I think the system is actually made in a way that makes it much easier for the coach.
We would like this project to have global impact so that every coach and every trainer in the sailing world is going to use this system and sort the waste. Next year at the World Championship, we're gonna give each coach boat a bag so that they can sort their waste. We're also going to put up the whole system so that it's easy to sort the waste at the whole event, so we can make sure that the waste is going to get into resources. It's as simple as that.
Yeah, we're really excited about the all-over positive feedback that we've got, and we're currently looking for partnerships to bring this system to all teams in Aarhus next year. It gives the sport of sailing a durable and adaptive solution for doing the right thing. Finally, last but not least, we want to address the specific agenda of fighting plastic in the oceans. With Plastic Change, we have a strong partner for whom fighting plastic in the ocean is right in the core of the mission statement. Plastic Change is an international organization that works explicitly for raising awareness about the consequences of the increasing plastic pollution of the oceans and the environment in general. Together with Plastic Change, it's our ambition, besides to inform and educate, to identify and implement specific solutions that will drive events like the Sailing World Championships towards being entirely plastic-free. We will work hard to move things in the right direction, and we know that every step matters. We believe by this to have set a strong team for supporting and driving forward a sustainable agenda at the Sailing World Championships in Aarhus next year. And we are determined to use this great opportunity of having the attention of thousands of people to leave a clear message on the right things to do to protect and preserve our unique field of play now and for the future. So this is our message. Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Thank you. Look forward to joining you next year. It's going to be here fast.
It will be good.
Yeah, the planning looks good. We have a very short video here by Julie Duffus. Julie leads the International Olympic Committee sustainability drive, and she worked in that capacity both in London and Rio. And so let's hear what the IOC has to say about how they're working with the various federations.
Hello to all of you in Mexico. I felt honored to be part of your sustainability forum, even if just virtually. I just wanted to take a short minute of your time to say a massive congratulations on the launch of your sustainability agenda and on the targets you are setting. It's an ambitious strategy, but one which is very much needed in sport. And I'm excited to see you raising the bar in sustainability. I also wanted to say that the IOC very much backs this strategy, and we are here to support and work with all of you at World Sailing on the delivery and implementation of your agenda. I've been working closely with some of you for several years now in Rio on the water quality, which was very challenging, but a challenge we overcame together. And then more recently with Dan on your sustainability strategy. And I cannot stress enough how important not only the collaboration between World Sailing and the IOC is, but also the many collaborations and partnerships that World Sailing have with your member national federations and partners. Time and time again, I see how vital and effective partnerships are in delivering sustainable goals. Globally, we are facing some very serious issues, and we can no longer sit down in isolation, can no longer stand by immune to these challenges of our time. We have got to join forces in order to make real change happen. So with that in mind, I work at the IOC to specifically help support international sport federations and national Olympic committees in their sustainability journeys, with an overall aim to bring sport as an entity together to tackle some of these challenges as one team. Tomorrow, we kick off the annual IF Forum here in Lausanne, and sustainability is a key theme this year, demonstrating that sport is not disregarding this important topic. All of us in sport have a huge role to play and a responsibility. We should not only be leading the sustainable agenda forward as a role model, but also should be inspiring others to follow. We have a unique, important global platform that we have the privilege to be part of. Water, climate change, health, food security, energy are just a few of the challenges communities around the world are facing. And the sport community is not immune from these. The Olympic movement has both an opportunity and a duty to actively contribute to the global sustainability agenda in line with its vision of building a better world through sport. And I truly believe that your Sustainability Agenda 2030 is a demonstration of commitment to this. We at the IOC have our own sustainability journey, and it's been a pleasure to work together on this, with to share ideas, best practice, knowledge, especially as both of our sustainable strategies are very much aligned. I truly believe that together we can make real positive change happen, and together we can raise awareness to inspire others to follow, to tackle these global issues, and to use sport as a catalyst for change. So from all of us here in Switzerland at the IOC, we wish you a successful forum, and I very much look forward to hearing the feedback from your consultation process.
All right, well, thank you, Julie. All right, if I could get Dan, Mike, Damien, Todd, Klaus, come join me here, and we have a few minutes left, so get your questions ready. Come on, have a chair. My goodness, we had enough chairs, all organized, well done. Well, first of all, thanks for your presentations. They were different, good. Klaus, I wonder if we're going to see some electric boats next year.
I would love to do it. It's still about range and capacity. We're operating for several hours during the entire day and need actually also the speed and the resistances. So I will get there, but not next year.
Mike, you had 59 initiatives that you plan to oversee in the coming years. What do you think the chances of success are?
Well, I think they're excellent. I mean, I think the commission was put together, obviously, to create various areas, the various recommendations. I mean, assuming they're all accepted and agreed upon, and obviously it's more likely that they'll be added to. I think sustainability, what we've seen consistently from pretty much every speaker today is that, you know, I like the phrase, you know, it's not a compromise. It's not a compromise, it's a genuine benefit. And you heard also from RS how it had actually benefited their business. And there's no reason why sustainability and following these measures can't have a real positive impact, not only on the environment and the sustainability of the sport, but actually beneficial to the efficient running of world sailing.
Todd, you've made a really good case, and I'm a believer with the electric motor, but it does take energy to charge up those batteries. What's the trade-off in energy between fossil fuels and electric?
Yeah. So as I said, it depends how you get that energy, and hopefully we can get it from a clean source most of the time. So solar, wind, and hydro generation are three opportunities in this industry where we can get a charge that is essentially zero emission from cradle to grave. You know, if we have to use in some installations, you'll need to have kind of that last resort of some sort of a diesel generator or a combustion generator that needs to be there for safety purposes, right? And some commercial applications require that by law. But the system should be designed so that in any normal instance, that wouldn't be necessary. So first we're charging with using those clean sources first.
You know, I've been charging the boat up, I hate to say, by plugging it in to electric, but I discovered there's these panels that are photovoltaic, and I can put it on the cover on the south side where I keep my boat, and it'll just charge it up and
sure.
Be ready to go every time. So I'm going to feel a little bit better, so I hope to have that in the next...
Yeah. Especially if you only use it once a week. If you're lucky enough to use it once a week, you'll get the charge, you know, during the downtime.
So Damien, I'm a little intrigued here by the Wildlife Federation, the group you were working with in Canada. Tell us a little bit about what that is and what your work was and how that extends itself to sailing.
Yeah, so the Canadian Wildlife Federation is the largest conservation organization in Canada. It's on one hand, they do an amazing amount of conservation work, habitat protection, species at risk, etc. But the other large body of their work is really around education. And when we talk about education in that context, it really was promoting nature connection for all with regards to, nature connection through education. So we would have done a lot of work with schools, with scout camps, with summer camps, and providing opportunities for people to get back outdoors. And we take that for granted, but it's become more and more recognized that actually this is really rather the exception rather than the rule. And it's the disconnection between people and nature is going to have some serious consequences going forward. So rectifying that. So yeah, it was really around using sport, using sailing, using water sports as a way of reconnecting with nature.
So Dan, a lot of this seems like common sense. I mean, when you think about it, a drink holder in the boat that you're going to be racing, and then providing the water bottle that actually fits in there so it doesn't go overboard and it fits pretty tight. So there must be a lot of little things like this that people are thinking about to make it all work.
Absolutely. I think a lot of it is looking at small steps, so early small gains, looking where the opportunities lie. So when we had our Sustainability Commission come together, it was very much a discussion of where are the opportunities and where we can focus some of our attention. Sometimes it will be bringing areas of best practice to different audiences. So if something's working well at a particular event or a certain country where technology is used, we can try and amplify that so other people are aware of it and can use it.
Mike, you think you're going to be a salesman here for the next several years as you try and convince people to take on these projects and think about this?
I really don't think it's a challenge. I think people are receptive. You're pushing on an open door in most quarters. And, I was very impressed by the RS presentation because there were things in there about the design, and that's something I personally love, having been involved with designing boats for pretty much most of my career. So I love the concept of stacking the boats, because when he first said that, and I'm sure I wasn't alone in the room thinking, well, how does that link to, that's a bit of a broad stretch to talk about the deck shape actually being a sustainable feature. But then when he flicked it out into transport, and all the other benefits that he laid out, I thought, well, that's perfect. It's exactly the right thing to do. I thought he did a pretty good job of pitching a new Olympic boat.
Yeah, well, I think everybody's pitching a little something here. It's part of the game. Klaus, I was intrigued that 42% of your power comes from wind energy around Denmark. And do you think, a lot of sails, and you're going to have hundreds of sail, almost 1,000 sailors come to Aarhus in a year and a half. Do you think a lot of those sailors will go home inspired by what they see and how the regattas run?
I think it's our ambition actually to do the information and making people aware of renewable energy. It's a big part of it. So I hope so.
Well, it sure looks good and impressive that you're able to do it. I think in the U.S. we're getting there. More and more windmills are up and getting power from lots of sources. But we do have a president that I'm not sure is quite bought in with the whole concept. But one of the things that I've learned about environmental issues is that all of us just chip away every little bit, and instead of 17 pieces of plastic, you have 2 pieces of. You just keep working at it, and that's what everybody's trying to do. So, how acceptable is electric motors in the marine industry? What are you finding? I mean, you're going to boat shows and.
Yeah.
See what the market is. I mean, people buying into this concept?
Absolutely. I mean, not just us, but I one way to answer the question is to say that we've got competitors that we never had before. in certain point solutions. So no one is offering kind of a broad, you know, a broad-based whole product line. But we've got competitors who are zeroing in on little pieces of the market. And we view this as very healthy. It broadens the whole customer base. People are starting to get very familiar and very comfortable with electric cars in general. That's only helping the marine industry. Of course, there's some downsides as well, some challenges rather, with you know lithium fires in kind of poorly designed products. So we haven't had any issues like that, but there's a lot of education, right? So it's not a quick sales discussion when you're talking with a potential customer. There's a lot of education to start, and then once they feel comfortable, they are convert.
Mike, you told us a horrifying story. You get stuck in this just massive garbage dump out there. Is there any efforts to go clean that stuff up? I mean, things do exist.
The strange thing about it, at the time, 1999, I looked at that and thought that's nature kind of collecting it all into one place. And obviously, there's no one dealing with it, but it was an indication that, in a way, the systems of nature were just drifting around the Caribbean Sea, actually picking up all this waste. Now, what happened to it? I guess it went in the jar and it broke into bits, and I guess a lot of that plastic is now in the small particles that Emily described to us. And, you know, back then it wasn't as well known about, so things like that were a slight oddity, and that was a slight oddity in the sense that, unlike many of the pictures that we've seen today, that was a natural occurrence that just happened to accumulate a lot of waste on it. But it was just a very indicative incident, and one that highlighted, I mean, strange, they always say strange things happen at sea, but I'm struggling to think of a stranger night than that one.
That was pretty wild. But thank goodness the whole thing was spinning around. You finally jibed and got
this
some.
This is a big boat, you know, it's a 60-foot long boat, a 100-foot rig, you know, it's a big boat, so you don't stop unless you hit something the bottom.
Well, earlier than the 19 years ago, I can remember people taking cans and breaking them up and throwing them overboard and saying, well, it'll disintegrate in a couple months and not worry about it. But then you learn these cans will last 400 years down there, and they don't disintegrate. And glass, you know, they get glass that's hundreds of years old. It's still down there, and the plastic is the worst at all.
Sure.
And in a little micro glass, I've seen some lectures on that, is horrifying. And, you know, Emily telling us about it's in her system and you can see it in your blood and what it does to fish. I mean, it was a horrifying picture to think that, you know, we're taking fish and eating it and people don't clean all of
I
the
think
fish.
It's really scary that, you know, we kind of see the waste and you see it on the most surface level. You see all these horror story pictures fleshed up. But I think what Emily managed to encapsulate when she spoke was the fact that it's filtering down into the ecosystem, and funnily enough, we're right there in the chain, and you know there's going to be some payback somewhere down the line, you know, and we don't necessarily know what that is. So the quicker we get on and address these issues, I mean, World Sailing and this forum is not individually going to be able to make a global impact on. You know, that kind of, the kind of, what was it, 3 million cubic tons of waste every year, we're not going to make an impact on that. But what we can do through the sport and through the awareness program is, first of all, make sure that as a sport we're as clean as we can possibly be, but through the sport also educate a much wider audience about, you know, the need to actually take corrective measures with these things, because how is all that plastic getting it? It really isn't coming from sailors. You know, I know people did tip stuff overside years ago, but those, you know, you don't see any of that now, and you wouldn't see a sailor do it. If anyone did it, they'd probably never get a ride again. So I've got good faith that sailors are almost entirely responsible about dealing with the environment. but sustainability is sometimes more than that.
So I mean, our friends over in the offshore level. And oceanic committee, you know, coming up with clever things. I mean, the days of tying up a spinnaker with yarn or putting rubber bands around at the set, that's not good. We don't want that in the water. Instead, you have Velcro.
Yeah.
You have zippers. So there are certainly good alternatives that probably actually work a little bit better. You know, over my shoulder here, you can see the screen here with Twitter comments, and Andy Hunt, our CEO, I like the one I'm reading here. Sustainability is not a compromise, it's a benefit. So that's a good line. We'll print that one. We'll have to keep that going there. All right, well, first of all, everybody that's here right now, thank you for hanging in. It's a long afternoon, but very interesting, and you're all ambassadors now, and I wonder if anybody here in our group and our family have any questions they'd like to ask. Sustainability, sailing. Any at all? Here we go.
I just like to ask a question to Todd, actually. Todd, in the automotive industry, most of the main manufacturers now have got it. You know, they've set incredibly ambitious targets. Volvo, our partner, are not going to produce only fossil fuel burning cars from 2019. Why is it that the outboard industry, you know, some of these incredibly large manufacturers just don't seem to have got it? And when do you think they will?
So we always get a lot of interest from the engineers, from the large outboard manufacturers at the shows. They want to take the top off, see inside. I think that I think they're just watching and just waiting for the right time. I don't think we haven't hit that tipping point yet where it makes sense for them to go in, you know, full power. So. Don't be surprised when you see it start to happen, that there's a much broader availability of that kind of product.
Thank you. By the way, we have the Yacht Racing Forum going to be in Aarhus in a couple weeks. I plan to be over there. Can you give us any preview, anything we should know?
Please say again.
The Yacht Racing Forum.
Yacht Racing Forum.
Is going to be in Aarhus in 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks, I think. And I plan to come over for that.
You caught me on the wrong foot here. We have a lot of interesting speakers at the Yacht Racing Forum, and I can't give you any insights.
Well, there's some good information on the internet, so I'm trying to give you a little a promo time. So, Damien, the boat Vestas 11th Hour Racing, you won the first leg. They're doing okay here. They're obviously missing you. But what do you think of the prospect for the team?
Yeah, well, I think you know, maybe 9 months ago we were a good team that was going to participate in the event and pull off a few results. Over the last few months, we've really put together. I think, you know, we're still improving. We're you know, going quickly up the learning curve. We pulled together a great group of people, which is now a fantastic lineup. We're 11 sailors for 8 slots. We're rotating through. And, you know, at the end of the day, this is a one design event on the second cycle. The differences between the boats are going to be very, very small. And, you know, while a couple of the boats might have got a jump start earlier on with earlier preparation, I think we can see those differences getting smaller and smaller. So. Yeah, we're well placed to continue what we've started so far, and you know, it's just you know, I think the sailing is one side of this project, which is fabulous, and you know, it's the Volvo Ocean Race and around the world, and we get to go to places that, you know, people like Mike seen it, and you know, very few of us see those places, but that's the opportunity for us to again showcase the beauty of the ocean. The baseline of the way the world and the ocean should be, blue. So, you know, now we have this is our role in this context, to put the blue back into our sport, to put the blue back in the ocean, and to, you know, engage a change for the better. And this is a fantastic opportunity to go forward. And you know, so as a team and as a Volvo Ocean Race event, that's what we're doing. And you know, it's great to be aligned with World Sailing on this.
I think Charlie Enright, the fact that he and some of these guys are going around for a second time certainly has got to be a benefit. And I've heard Charlie Enright speak 6 or 8 times around the U.S. after the last race, and as recently just a few months ago up in Newport, Rhode Island. He is a great ambassador for you guys. He's a really good sailor, but he speaks well and with such passion. He and Mark, I think, are a really good team. All right, anybody else have any questions they'd like to ask at all? Well, let me just say thank you to our panel. You came well prepared, all of you, and I'm glad we got the hookup out there in the ocean, heading at 200 degrees at 20 knots. We're all jealous and getting our hookups and videos. And like I said, Andy, you and your team, between the women's program yesterday and the sustainability, it's a better format. And as a guy that spends a lot of time around film and video, I just love seeing these big screens and good sound and everything. So let's give our panelists a good hand. Thank you very much.